Adam and Eve had turned from God's ways and were banished forever from the Garden of Eden. But God gave them the power to have children. In fact, when Eve gave birth to their firstborn son, she said, "With the help of the Lord, I have brought forth a man." Adam and Eve named their firstborn son Cain. Shortly after, they had a second son, whom they named Abel. When they grew up, Cain became a farmer, working the land for food. Abel became a shepherd, watching over the family's flock of animals. One day, both Cain and Abel brought gifts to God, called offerings. Cain offered God some of the fruit he had grown. Abel offered God some of the firstborn, best animals from his flock. God looked with favor on Abel's offering of animals, but not on Cain's offering of fruit. Cain was very angry. God asked Cain, "Why are you angry? Why is your face downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you, but you must rule over it." Cain said to his brother Abel, "Let's go out to the field." Then, while they were in the field, Cain attacked his brother and killed him. Later on, God spoke to Cain. "Where is your brother?" God asked. "I don't know," Cain replied. "Am I my brother's keeper?" God said, "What have you done? Listen, your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground." Because of what Cain did, God cursed him. "When you work the ground, it will no longer yield its crops for you." God went even further, banishing Cain from the land where he lived with his family. Cain said to God, "My punishment is more than I can bear. Whoever finds me will kill me." But God said, "Not so. Anyone who kills you will suffer 7 times over. Then God put a mark on Cain so that anyone who found him would not kill him. Cain then left his family and God's presence, moving just east of Eden, where he began a family of his own.
Morning, New Hope. You're probably wondering a couple of things. One is, what am I doing up here? And the second is, why is there a board on the office? I don't know if you saw that, but we'll cover both those things this morning. But first, I want to welcome all visitors, first-time visitors or guests today. Please, if you wouldn't mind, take time to fill out the card in front of you on the pink side, the visitor's side. I know it's a hard thing to do sometimes, but 3.5 years ago, my wife and I did it, and it was well worth it. We were embraced by a fantastic family here at New Hope. So I would encourage you to do that. We promise here that we will not beat on your door, bother you on the phone, but through the mail, send you some information about what we do here at New Hope. Tim is obviously not here. He's in Angola, and I don't mean Africa, Angola. That was my first thought. We went early to Africa. There is apparently an Angola in Louisiana, and there's a prison there which is quite famous. It's the biggest prison in the U.S., and it just happens to be one of the prisons that has the highest population of people serving a life sentence. It was considered to be one of the most dangerous prisons in the U.S., and was called the Alcatraz of the South. I think it still is called that. Anyway, Tim had an opportunity to go to the rodeo there. It's famous for its rodeo at the prison, and Tim always likes a good rodeo, so he went along, and obviously there's other stuff he will do in the prison as well while he's there, but so we'll be praying for him today as he does his work behind prison walls as well as see the rodeo. I did get a note yesterday from Shelley about this rodeo, and I just wanted to share a couple of the events that they have there, which sounds a little insane, but I guess if you're in prison, you might not have much to lose, but one of them is convict poker, and I saw a picture of this online, and there's basically 4 of the convicts sit around a square table playing a friendly game of poker on plastic chairs, and then they release a huge bull, and the bull basically is there to try and unseat all of the members at the table quite aggressively, and the last one sitting on the chair is the one that wins. So I don't know how long you win for, but you know, it's that's just one of them. The other one, Guts and Glory, is another one. There's a poker chip, or a poker chip is attached to the toughest Brahma ball available. The object is to get close enough to the ball in order to snatch that chip, and that's the last event of the day, probably because, for obvious reasons, I think, but one of the other things they did say, which amused me, was, which one was it, where they basically say that they attach a whole bunch of inmates to, so it's the bull riding, and they attach them to a bunch of bulls, and they all release them at the same time, but the way they phrased it was they're temporarily attached, which I think was probably a very... very true statement, but for how long, I don't know. But anyway, so that's what Tim is doing, and so he's not here today. The board on the window, unfortunately, we had a break-in this week, a couple of days ago. I know it's... I cannot understand why people will break into anything, let alone a church. It seems a very dangerous thing to play with your spiritual life that way. But, you know, the nonprofit that we have as well, we had checks stolen a while back, and it really irks me that people feel, if you have to steal, why do it from people that really need it? So anyway, so the rest of the announcements. The first meeting of the new ministry, Widows to Widows, is on tomorrow in the Holy Grounds at 7 p.m. So I'd encourage anyone that needs that support to go to that and encourage that new ministry. Tuesday night is the start of the study of Ephesians for men's Bible study, the Tuesday night men's Bible study. That starts at 6:45. If you have any questions about that, Gene is the one that runs that. And this month we'll have a baptism service. It'll be an evening one because of the Believe series. We'll be doing it on the 19th, so Sunday the 19th in the evening. If you're interested in baptism, fill out a card and put it in the offering, and someone will contact you about that and the details associated with it. The 19th is also Pastor Appreciation Sunday. So that'll be a day when you can really show your appreciation for the incredible pastoral staff that we have here at New Hope. So I'd encourage you to try and make it that day. Well, every day, but, you know, especially that day. The Christmas choir, the adult Christmas choir, because we're going to talk about the children's Christmas choir as well. Christmas choir has started their rehearsals in here on Wednesday evenings. It's not too late to join that, so if you want to join that, come along Wednesday evening and join the rehearsal. The Children's Christmas Choir will be starting rehearsals, I cannot remember, October 19th. It's a busy day, October 19th. So 12:15, I'm not sure where it's going to be. I don't know if Randy's in here, but last time it was in the bridge, so I'm not sure if it'll be over there. But so that'll be on the 19th as well, so... Adult Christmas Choir on Wednesday evenings. Children's Christmas Choir starts October 19th at 12:15. The weekend of the 24th through the 26th. Big weekend here at New Hope. A lot of fests going on. So it's a festival weekend. We've got Hope Fest Friday, which will be an incredible event. We've got four worship bands from four churches that are going to be here. So that'll be quite an amazing event. We've never been done, so it's... I would encourage you to come to that. Bring people to it. I mean, it's going to be huge, and there'll be a lot of fun for the kids as well. So bring the whole family for that. The Harvest Fest will be on that Sunday, the 26th, and that'll be after third service. So if you like free tri-tip or free hot dogs, then that will be the place to be, and that'll be after the third service. And then there'll be lots of kids' entertainment, bounce houses, stuff like that. So it's... that'll be a great day here at New Hope. It always is a good event. 1 p.m. today, children's musical rehearsal. Children's musical play rehearses in here at 1 p.m. I don't know if it's too late to sign up for that, but if we're still looking for people. Yep, never too late, right? So if you're interested in your children being in the musical play, then have them come along at 1 p.m. today. Also, the golf tournament today is... the final day, technically, for sign-ups on the golf tournament. We just need names. Don't have to pay yet, but that's on the 18th, Saturday the 18th. So if you want to sign up for that, you can see Teddy Miller or Eric Olson, and They'll get you signed up. The money for that, what's raised in that, goes towards Celebrate Recovery. I think that's it. So out in the pavilion, we have these Believe key tags, and Tim talked about them last week. So they have all 30 of the verses and 30 of the 10 of the key truths, 10 key practices, and 10 key virtues that we've been talking about in the Believe series. They're $3 out in the pavilion. Also, the Believe Bibles are out there. Again, they're $10, $5, or free, depending on your financial situation. So Nancy is selling those out in the pavilion. We have prayer requests today. Janice Dunnington and her family. Ed, her husband, died last Wednesday night in their home, and the memorial service will be here at New Hope on Friday at 11 a.m. And then pray for the family of Thelma Chase, that's Fern Wood's sister. The services for that will be on Wednesday at 11 a.m. And then we'll pray for Marianne Ramirez, Lisa Perez's mom, who has stage 4 liver cancer. And Ray Steele, who was diagnosed and undergoing treatment for lung cancer. So those are all the prayer requests. So today we'll continue the Belief series. Gene is going to take us through key truth number 7, which is humanity. How does God see us, and what does he want us to do about it? We've already touched on the subjects of God, personal God, salvation, the Bible, identity in Christ, and the church. So now we're on key truth number 7. So this series, for those of you that don't know, challenges us with 10 key truths to start, 10 key practices, and then finally 10 key virtues, all associated with the Belief Bible. And if you don't have a copy, there should be visitors' copies in the pew in front of you so that you can follow along with the sermon. So we have a couple of clipboards. Okay, that's for...
These are just for Hope Fest. We just need some volunteers to help out with parking attendance because the Hope Fest will be out in the parking lot. So we're doing parking is going to be on the dirt over here, and we're actually utilizing the Copelands have graciously opened their property for us to use as parking as well. So we just need help with directing parking. And then we just need a few helpers in our kids area as well. We will have Bubbles the Clown and an assistant at first, but that's only 2 people, and we're hoping to have a lot more kids than that. So I'll just be passing these around on either side. Thank you.
Thank you. And I'll ask our ushers to come forward while those clipboards are going around. Okay, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are honored to be your servants day to day, and we thank you for the ability to gather here today, together without any danger, to openly worship you without fear of retribution, arrest, or even death, as is common in so many countries. We pray that as a church we find opportunities to serve here in our own local community and in other places such as Angola or Colombia. And we pray today particularly for those that are in danger in Iraq and Syria, families of the living or the executed hostages at the hands of ISIS. We can't imagine as we sit here in a Clovis church the horrific ordeals that they're going through in that part of the world. We pray that the leadership of this country and other Western countries, we pray for them as they consider their actions on how to deal with this and the other growing crises in the world. We thank you for all the blessings that you've given us here at this church, and we're grateful for the opportunity to give for your kingdom's work. We pray in the incredible name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
If you know me, you know I'm about a 20-minute guy. But I got to tell you, after watching that baseball game last night, I'm inspired. 18 innings, 2 days, and a Giants win. But, you know, the Bible says a leopard doesn't really change its spots, so you don't have to worry too much. It was a good game. If I could pick one verse of Scripture to summarize the Believe series so far, it would have to be Ephesians chapter 2, verses 19 to 22. Paul writes, "You are no longer foreigners and aliens, but fellow citizens with God's people and members of God's household. That's chapter 6, the church. Built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets. That's chapter 4, the Bible. With Christ Jesus Himself as the chief cornerstone. That's chapter 3, salvation. In Him the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. That's chapter 5, identity in Christ. And in Him you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by His Spirit. That's chapter 2, a personal God. And that brings us to chapter 7 in the Believe series. And the focus is now upon us, God's hands-on creation. The title of the chapter is Humanity. The best place to start is where it all began, in the first book of the Bible, the book of Genesis. You know the words, in the beginning, God. The Genesis story of creation is for the Christian a wondrous account of our beginnings and God's total provision for all of humanity. It isn't like the free weekend that I won several years ago. Of course, all I had to do was pay my travel to get there, pay for the food and the entertainment, and sit through a high-pressure sales pitch so I could spend 3 glorious days in what was described as paradise. Oh, the Genesis account is complete and it is perfect. The testimony of God's unselfish giving of Himself for our benefit. For you see, God did not need what He created. His dwelling was complete within Himself. God had absolute satisfaction in Himself, and He dwelt joyfully complete in eternity as what we call the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. They were in perfect fellowship with one another from all eternity. Jesus said, in John chapter 17, and now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory that I had in you before the foundation of the world. Much like the mystery of a married man and a woman manifests itself through their love for each other, and that love is then expressed in the creation of children. So the love of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit manifested itself through creation in general and humanity in particular. Ephesians 1 says this, for He, God, chose us in Him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in His sight. He predestined us to be adopted as His sons through Jesus Christ, in accordance with His pleasure and will. All creation, from the creation of ocean, earth, and sky, according to Genesis chapter 1, was good in God's sight, as were plant and animal life. But when God finished creation by forming with His own hands man and woman, not only was it good, but the Bible says God's words were these, it is very good. But there was a dark cloud on the horizon. It involved a forbidden tree, and God's admonishment to Adam and Eve that to touch the tree meant death. There was temptation from Satan and the exercise of Adam's free will, with the result of the beginning of the decay of God's perfect creation. Adam becomes the origin of death and of decay of humanity. Along with God's gift of His love in creation came the responsibility of free will for mankind. His perfect spiritual DNA was forever changed through the selfish act of rebellion against God, and humanity was forever changed. Now, for some, this may raise a question or two. Did God create evil? Of course, the answer is no. Evil is not a thing like a rock or a tree or a fish. You cannot have a jar full of evil. Evil has no existence of its own. Rather, it is actually the absence of God. You may ask, does cold exist? The answer is no. Cold is simply the absence of heat. Darkness does not exist. Darkness is the absence of light. Likewise, evil is the absence of good. Or better said, evil is the absence of God. And when Adam sinned, perfect fellowship with God was broken. So God did not create evil, but rather he only allowed for the absence of good through the disobedience of Adam. Yet we struggle with this truth. As finite human beings, we can never fully understand an infinite God. And Paul agreed. Listen what he wrote in the book of Romans. Oh, the depth of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable his judgments and his paths beyond a tracing out. Who has known the mind of the Lord? Or who has been his counselor? One thing we do acknowledge: as a result of Adam's sin, humanity is in a mess. It's easy to become both overwhelmed and desensitized as we listen to the daily news records about the massive problems throughout the world. Poverty, disease, natural disasters, economic crises, random violence, sadistic dictators, nuclear threats, and the list goes on and on. It makes it seem as though some kind of evil is destined for every day's headlines. It's no longer the Fresno Bee. It's the Daily Sin Report. Yet as we saw last Sunday in the chapter on the church, the focus for us really isn't on saving the world, but rather on loving and obeying Jesus. The central question is not, what problem of the world do I attempt to solve today? But rather, what would Jesus have me do for him? Not only is the focus vastly different, but the motivation comes from the proper place. As Jesus said, we are to love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And then we are to love our neighbor, or love humanity, as we love ourselves. Simply deciding to be humanitarian is certainly a noble goal. And there are many organizations doing that, from PETA to Greenpeace. But while social justice has become an increasing focus of the church in the last decade, obeying God and joining Him in His work are the best labors of love we can offer as we serve one another through the one who saved us. Jesus Himself is our goal and our purpose. The work is simply the result of what we do as we walk with Him within the relationship that He has established in our lives. The Apostle Paul said it this way when he wrote to the Colossian church. He is the one we proclaim, admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone fully mature in Christ. To that end, Paul said, I strenuously contend with all the energy Christ so powerfully works in me. That brings us to a key question. In view of the condition of the world, how does God see people? How does God see humanity? We find the answer in the familiar words of John 3:16. Allow me, please, to read it to you from Eugene Peterson's modern English paraphrase, The Message. This is how much God loved humanity. He gave His Son, His one and only Son, and this is why, so that no one need be destroyed. By believing in Him, anyone can have a whole and lasting life. God didn't go to all the trouble of sending His Son merely to point an accusing finger, telling the world how bad it was, but He came to help, to put the world right again. And now He is asking us to join Him. Scripture is clear to communicate that God loves all people the same. His heart is to take us back to the garden. He loves the man in prison who committed a heinous crime as much as He does the faithful Sunday school teacher. He loves the tiny child struggling to survive in the desert of the Sudan as much as the Hollywood celebrity living in luxury. God sees all, He hears all, He loves all, and He and He alone is sovereign over all of humanity. As the Apostle Paul worked diligently to establish and sustain churches, his calling for God was always crystal clear, as is ours, to reach out to all people. In the first chapter of Romans, Paul said this, I am obligated both to Greeks and non-Greeks, both to the wise and the foolish. That is why I am so eager to preach the gospel also to you who are in Rome. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew, then to the Gentile. For in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last, just as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. And then Paul said, the wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of people who suppress the truth by their wickedness. Since what may be known about God is plain to them, because God has made it plain to them. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, His eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that humanity is without excuse. Since the wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of people, this is exactly why all people, all humanity, needs to be saved. As the old adage goes, the ground is level at the foot of the cross. Note also that Paul's words in this passage of Scripture that I've just read is that people are without excuse. God says He will reveal Himself in some manner to everyone. An invitation to salvation is offered to mankind. All have sinned. All wickedness is to be punished. All need salvation. All are offered salvation, and all are without excuse. Another key truth is this: all people are loved by God and need Jesus Christ as their Savior. So why does humanity need Jesus? Just as sin entered the world because God had a singular requirement of Adam not to touch the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, John records these singular words of Jesus. I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. This key truth has a key application, and that application is this: what difference does this make in the way that I live. How would life change if we started to see people as God sees them? How would the world change if you and I truly believed the only way for people to enter heaven is through Christ? Number one, we value all human life. David wrote in Psalm 139, "For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body, and all the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be." I do this by valuing all of human life. Number two, we see and treat all people the way God sees and treats them. In Galatians chapter 3, Paul said, "In Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the purpose." Number three, we are compelled to tell people about Jesus. In 1 Peter 3:15, the Apostle Peter says, "In your hearts, set aside or sanctify Christ as Lord, and always be prepared to give an answer to anyone who asks you about the hope that you have." When should we be prepared? Always. What should we give them? An answer. Who should we be prepared to give an answer to? Everyone. What is the reason for our hope and our answer? Christ Jesus, who is Lord of all. Paul writes again in Romans, "How then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one whom they have not heard? How can they hear without someone preaching to them? How can anyone preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news." Let me ask us a question. Have you looked at your spiritual feet lately? Do they stink or do they refresh? In chapter 5 of book number 2 in Operation Timothy, we understand that we are uniquely insiders in the lives of people who may never darken the door of the church. It may be through our work, it may be through our hobbies, it may be through other interests. There are several ways in which your life and mine touch another person outside the church, but touch them we do. On the opening page of that chapter in Operation Timothy, an illustration is taken from Charles Swindoll's book, Come Before Winter. This is the illustration. Swindoll tells the anecdote of Oliver Cromwell. It seems the British government began to run low on silver for coins. Lord Cromwell sent his men on an investigation of a local cathedral to see if they could find any precious metals there. They reported, "The only silver we could find were the statues of the saints standing in the corners," to which the radical soldier and statesman Oliver Cromwell replied, "Good. We'll melt down the saints and put them into circulation." We are the saints. How do our feet smell? Do they stink, or are they the fragrance of the good news of the message of Jesus Christ. He needs to melt us down and to put us into circulation. There's someone right now in your circle of influence who needs to hear the story of salvation and redemption. It is the mandate of what we call the Great Commission, recorded in Matthew 28:19-20. Go, baptize, and teach. There is an urgency for us to do this because Paul paints a bleak picture of humanity in the first chapter of Romans, a picture that is as true today as when Paul wrote it. Listen, he is describing humanity. They have become filled with every kind of wickedness, evil, greed, depravity. They are full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, and malice. They are gossips, slanderers, God-haters, insolent, arrogant, and boastful. They invent ways of doing evil. They disobey their parents. They are senseless, faithless, heartless, and ruthless. And although they know God's righteous decree that those who do such things deserve death, they not only continue to do these very things, but also approve of those who practice them. But as the commercial says, but wait, there's more. Paul continues to write, and in the first two words of Romans 3:21, they may be the most important words in the entire book of Romans. Paul, after painting this depressing picture of humanity, simply says these two words, but now. But now. Let me read it to you. But now righteousness from God apart from law has been made, to which the law and the prophets testify. The righteousness from God comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified freely by His grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. So there you have it. Perfection was destroyed by sin, and sin has become the hallmark of humanity. Sin was destroyed by the redemption that came through Jesus Christ. And now a line is drawn through all of humanity. We see it in 1 John chapter 5, 11, 12, where it says, and this is the testimony that God has given to us, eternal life. And this life is in His Son. And here's the division. He who has the Son has life, but he who does not have the Son does not have life. If our greatest need had been information, God would have sent an educator. If our greatest need had been technology, God would have sent us a scientist. If our greatest need had been money, God would have sent us an economist. If our greatest need had been pleasure, God would have sent an entertainer. But our greatest need was forgiveness. And so God sent us a Savior. In the opening words of Romans, Paul presents five truths. Number one, Paul teaches the Romans a distinctive righteousness that comes from above and not from natural human perspectives. Every day the media is filled with stories of people who attempt to gain acceptance with acts of human righteousness. It is only when men are willing to admit that there is no hope in human effort to be righteous that they are ready to accept God's remedy for sin. 90% of the human race is still on the losing side of this battle. Out of the 6 billion people on the earth, there are probably around 700 million who have personally trusted Christ to be their righteous forgiver. Jesus said it best, "Narrow is the gate that leads to life, and few are those who find it." This presents us with an admonition and a goal. And that is this: ask the Lord to help you to do all you can to concentrate on helping the 90% of this world's population who are yet to find their righteousness in Christ. Sometimes we lose perspective when we talk about billions and millions. So let me bring it a bit closer to our own reality. From January 1st, 2014 to September 1st of 2014, in the city of Clovis, the police department answered 908 calls for service, 225 runaways, 108 attempted suicides, 161 mental health calls, and 40 chaplain calls. As I discussed with the officers early Thursday morning here at the church, any time they are called, or those of us who serve as chaplains are called, it is never good. I can guarantee you that none of these calls had anything to do with people experiencing the righteousness of God. Number two, Paul shows the Romans how God freely gives true righteousness. So many individuals, institutions, and churches continue to believe that if they just continue to do the right things, they will make it into heaven. That's wrong. God's righteousness is a free gift of God's grace through faith in Christ, not as the result of works, so that no one can boast. You know the passage. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. Religion is human effort to reach up to God. Saving faith results when God reaches down to us to help us to receive the free gift of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ. Another challenge for us is that we should ask the Lord to help us appreciate the fact that freely we have received, therefore, we are to freely give to humanity. Number three, Paul shows how Christ has laid the foundation for the imputing of God's righteousness through his suffering and obedience. Divine righteousness is imputed to us, meaning that it is put into our soul's bank account in the person of the Holy Spirit. To impute means to attribute to another and ascribe goodness and qualityness to someone. God boasts or boosts our sense of confidence, our hope and power. He will never leave us or forsake us, so that we can confidently say, "The Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. The Lord is the strength of my life. In him I gain my strength." Another admonition for us in view of what we have just said is that we should ask the Lord to help us draw more and more on the rich reservoir of his bank account of righteousness. Number four, Paul teaches the Romans that the righteousness of Christ is available for all who will believe, regardless of a person's background, ethnicity, or social standing. Each individual must find their righteousness of Christ or sadly face eternity in hell. There is no other way for anyone to reach heaven except through the righteousness of Christ. Again, the application for us is that we should let the Lord work in our hearts through this truth and do all we can to bring all men to a personal knowledge of Christ's righteousness. Number five, Paul states that there are certain conditions to be met before one can receive Christ's righteousness. The great apostle shows that one must trust Christ as one's personal Savior to be substitutionary payment for all past, present, and future sins. This faith is not just an intellectual assent or acknowledgement of a fact. Instead, it is an expression of one's heart's mind and willing consent to be what God wants us to become. The essential point of each soul must be brought into a personal relationship with Christ as Savior. Again, our admonishment, ask the Lord to help you allow the righteousness of Christ in you to shine the light to those who are still suffering in the darkness of human righteousness. In Christ, we have a love that can never be fathomed, a life that can never die, a righteousness that can never be tarnished, a peace that can never be understood, a rest that can never be disturbed, a joy that can never be diminished, a hope that can never be disappointed, a glory that can never be clouded, light that can never be darkened, a purity that can never be defiled, a beauty that can never be marred, a wisdom that can never be baffled, and resources that can never be exhausted. How does he look at humanity? He looks at them as needing a Savior. And we, according to Matthew 28:19-20, are God's plan A. Go, baptize, teach, and there is no plan B. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the love that caused you to create this world and to create us. And even though we failed you, we thank you for the love that sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to meet the need of our heart and to draw us back to you. But Father, we recognize today that there are so many that have not yet experienced that love and have not come to a place of fellowship with you. Humanity indeed is in need of a Savior. Father, thank you for who we are and for what we have in Jesus Christ. Give us the opportunity this week to share that with someone who so desperately needs it. Dismiss us with your blessing, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.